Everybody.
So, hello everyone, my name is Sandra Fox and I'm speaking to you for today from Italy, near Milan, where I live and work. Today we'll be looking at flashcard practice activities for primary school age and young learner students. The flashcards that I used during the webinar are from the Cambridge Resources for Young Learner Exam Preparation, but the activities are suitable for other flashcards too. I will very quickly show you how the particular flashcards fit with the other Young Learner resources from Cambridge, but in the main agenda, we will be thinking about flashcards, how you use them for vocabulary, but most of the webinar, we'll look at some activities for more than vocabulary, how we can use flashcards to produce more than just individual words, how to manage these activities in class, variations on them, and all while keeping the Young Learner exams in mind as to how those activities may directly or indirectly prepare the children for starters, movers, or flyers and specific parts of those exams. At the end, I will show you how you can access the flashcards, but those of you who are signed into this webinar live will also receive that in an email, the links in an email. And a couple of times during the webinar, I'll pause for any questions about those particular activities just shown, plus a bit of a pause at the end for other questions. So before any of that, I'd like you to think about your own teaching experiences and flashcards. And I'm going to ask you this question. Could you write your answer in the chat? I use flashcards in my lessons often, sometimes, never slash rarely. Could you type in the chat O, S or N? Often, sometimes. Always, yeah, often, sometimes, couple of nevers. I suspect that's probably because you've not had chance yet or you've not yet started teaching young learners very much. Okay, that's great. A lot of you are using them very much. I think we can probably agree that flashcards are one of our most helpful teaching tools, especially for the young learners. And those of you who've not yet had a chance to use them, I hope you get some ideas today that you feel confident to go and try or enthusiastic to try. So still thinking about your experience before we get into the activities, what type of things, they may be words, they may be pictures, but what type of language items or topics tend to be on the flashcards that you've seen and used? Can you type that into the chat? Weather, parts of the body, food, animals, yes. Okay, yes, vocabulary, but which areas of vocabulary? Phrases, family, rooms, yes. Okay, I think we can, perhaps the most common flashcards are things with tangible objects. Food, animals, furniture, toys, for example. Other nouns like sports, jobs, places, numbers, the time and seasons. Verbs and actions, for example, running and dreaming and so on. Although you may often use miming rather than flashcards to actually present those words, you may use flashcards to practice them. And then perhaps less often we think about flashcards for feelings, but you get happy and sad and so on. Describing words would include colour and other adjectives. But also when we get up to flyers level, we might have words like wooden, plastic, spotted or striped, like the ones shown here on the left. Now, all of the flashcards that you see in today's presentation can be found in the free teacher's resource as downloadable booklets. There's one for starters, movers and flyers. Of course, if you're preparing students for movers, you'd also use the starters ones. If you're preparing for flyers, you'd also use the starters and movers ones because they're accumulative. Now, thinking about the other material with Cambridge, we have these word list picture books that are also downloadable. And in them, there are these colourful pictures with lots of action in them. If you look at the resources, you'll see that the flashcards correlate to these scenes. For example, the costumes there, you can see them on the stage at the back of the poster. Another flashcard here, we've got the musical instruments that you can see on the right. So the material slots together. It doesn't mean you have to use them all at the same time, but there is continuity. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the Young Learner exams, there are vocabulary lists, and any of the words that are used in the exam can be found on these vocabulary lists. There's starters, movers, and flyers, again, adding as you go up the level. Here under sports and leisure, for example, we've got the words at flyers level would be violin, drum, and concert. At movers level, we've got the word band. If you're looking at the topic of clothes in flyers, you'd find the word costume. Okay, so that shows how the material slots together. So here's a quick example of a very simple activity that we might use when they are learning new or revising old vocabulary. It's called Fast Finger. Now, the set of cards up here might seem to be a bit random, but I chose these because, imagine, I'm pre-teaching and I've already presented some new words and I'm revising them, other words, which will appear in a story or a game. And I want that next activity to run more smoothly. So I'm doing this as a fast finger as a warmer. I've shown 9 cards here, but this works well with more pictures. Someone has once suggested to me not to teach perhaps more than 8 new words in a single lesson. I found that to be quite a useful guide over the years. So perhaps let's move on to looking at this particular teacher is going to use Fast Finger, and they have the topic of places. They've put lots of words on the board. So what does he do? Well, he says one of the words, for example, cave. He then points to the cards and he moves his arms smoothly and slowly the first time to zigzag or snake along the rows. And when he crosses the picture of cave, the children have to shout stop. Now, you can turn this into more of a game by giving the teacher the point if the teacher's fat finger moves faster, or you can give the point to the children if they stop them in time. The idea is that you get faster and faster. You may be going up and down, backwards, from the bottom up. Okay, so this particular teacher was doing vocabulary for a new topic. Recently, I used this for transport vocabulary. I was revising a topic they already knew. I used snowboarding and skiing as transport too. And this was because it was just a revision to then go on to something else. So it's a very simple activity. Can you think for a moment about your favorite flashcard activities? They may be ones you use to pre-teach for another activity, as I did for my story lesson there, or there may be new words in a topic I've just presented. For example, the mountain, the lake, or it might be revising Lexis as my example with the transport. It doesn't matter. What can you just write down what your favorite flashcard activity is called? Put it in the chat. What's missing? Memory. Yes, many people in countries call, so a lot of countries call memory the game where you, it's Pelmanism or matching pairs, where you turn over 2 cards and have to find them the same and say what they are. Yes, odd one out. Memory challenges, bingo, brainstorming, excellent. Okay, so some of the flashcard activities are mentioned in the packs that come with the flashcards. There's a teacher guide, so you'll find some extra ideas there. So one of my favorite activities, I think this is probably familiar to some of you, look at the pictures here, and this is called Kim's Game traditionally, but there's a similar version called Disappearing Words. So look, remember, Close your eyes. Now look. What's missing? Don't write this, just you can say it. It's the racing car. Look again. Close your eyes. Look. What's missing now? It's the fire engine. So when you put the word back each time, it's called Kim's game traditionally. If, however, you want to just keep the words disappearing one by one by one until there are none remaining, then I would call that disappearing words. So they close their eyes between each one. When they look back, they say what the last one was to disappear, racing cars. Okay. So stronger students might want to say the racing cars are missing, or here there are no racing cars, which does also come in handy when they do their speaking test. So what, however, if we want to use flashcards for more than vocabulary? We know that we use them to present new language. We use them to practice recognition of the meaning of new words, for example, fast finger. So receptive skills, or we use them to prompt students to say or write a word. So productive skills. They're ideal for warmers before activities, revision or breakers. But if we want to exploit the flashcards further, well, let's imagine I want my children in the class to use a dialogue. I'm going to call this activity a chain mini dialogue, because the way the dialogue moves around the classroom is like the links in a chain. So the dialogue I want to practice is, what is it? It's a lizard. Pardon? It's a lizard. Thank you. So what do we do? Okay, I put the start the activity as a whole open class activity, putting the students in one big circle with one card at a time. So the teacher has the card and prompts student B to ask, what is it? It's a plane. Pardon? It's a plane. Thank you. And B takes the card. B then turns to face C, and you prompt C to ask this time, what is it? It's a plane. Pardon? It's a plane. Thank you. And so on. C, of course, then takes the card and passes it to D. And the card and the dialogue move around the circle. Eventually, the last student turns to the teacher and can do the dialogue with the teacher, returning the card back to you. In small classes, you could wait until the card arrives back from the final student. But in most classes, I would introduce another card. When it's partway, the first one's partway round, I would introduce the second card and encourage B to ask the question, what is it? It's a spaceship. And continue to feed in more cards around the circle. If you have a particularly large class, rather than the children near the end of the circle waiting a long time for their turn, I'd go over to the middle of the circle and feed in cards at their points. So I can have many cards going round and none of the children have to wait too long. But as always, the teacher needs to judge the pace when they have all understood and when they have the first dialogue going round the circle well, and if they're ready for another card. The teacher will also need to continue to prompt and help the students in the circle with the dialogue as they need it. So let me ask you a question now. Imagine I want to do a chain mini dialogue, so the same activity and a similar dialogue, but I want to use these cards, racing cars, roller skates, and sunglasses. What is the dialogue that you could encourage them to practice in the chain as they go round? Could you write it in the chat? What are they? Yes. Yeah. What are these? They both work. What are these? Yeah. Okay, thinking about a similar dialogue to the one that they've just seen. Yes, okay, so we're looking at this dialogue here. What are they? Or what are these? They're roller skates. Pardon? They're roller skates. Thank you. Matt, I'd just like to add that I would not introduce this in the same lesson as I did what is it, unless the purpose of my lesson is when they're ready and they're at higher level to actually be focusing on having them both in the same lesson, switching from singular to plural. Okay. Let me move to here. In the Young Learner exams, the students have to answer the questions, what is it or what are they, in starters speaking. But they may want to say, pardon, sorry, can you repeat that? In the starters, the movers, and or the flyers speaking. So as in our classes, it's good to encourage students to say when they don't understand something, if it happens in their speaking test. If they can say pardon or sorry, then they have strategies to help their communication. And as young learner examiners, we would see that favorably and recognize it when it's needed. We also know that it's better for the children emotionally to feel more comfortable if they can say pardon rather than sitting in agitation and silence. So, of course, in any activity, as in the exam, each child will produce language at their own personal level and ability. So some of the children may be answering lizard, a lizard, is lizard, it's a lizard. The other day I did this with clothes items, the singular. They were focusing a lot on practicing what is it, and many were answering just the one word because it was too much to say it's a. So each child and each class is going to do that according to their level. However, what we're looking to do is encouraging them to give their best response, their best personal response. So thinking still about a mini chain dialogue, instead of doing what is it or what are they, this is obviously okay for also practicing can you, yes I can, no I can't. Instead of just having the cards in piles and picking them up and asking and answering, the mini chain dialogue gives us another way to practice the same language. With the first dialogue there, I would use things like actions, sports, musical instruments. What cards would you use if you wanted to practice the dialogue? Do you like? Yes, I do. No, I don't. Have you got? Yes, I have. No, I haven't. It may be with pardon. You may decide not to practice it with pardon. That doesn't matter. But which are the cards you would use? Food. Yes, a lot of you, I'm assuming that you're thinking about food with likes, colors with likes, sports, toys, possessions with got. Yeah. Okay. Yes. So I also agreed that I had activities for food, sports, and animals for the do you like? And I'd have toys, pets, and even pencil case type of school vocabulary for have you got? So let's leave that activity and move on to another one. Now, TPR, total physical response. For anyone who's unsure what that means, it means it's when you react physically to some input or stimulus that the teacher has given. So in this particular example, I'm going to use the instruction stand up or sit down. And in this activity, although it's a listening activity, I have in mind the first part of the reading papers when they need to recognize if the statements are true or false, writing yes or no. So the teacher shows different cards one by one to the open class. Here I'm showing this friendly green man with this instruction for each. Stand up if yes, it's true, I'm right. Sit down if no, it's false, it's wrong. This is a monkey. sorry. This is a monkey you're sitting. This is a mouse you're standing. This is an alien. Now you're standing. So let me repeat that. This is a monkey, you sit. This is a mouse, you sit. This is an alien, you stand. So this is at starter's level. This is these are in part one of reading and writing. At movers and flyers, they'll start to see definitions instead. And this activity you could use by saying, it lives on a farm, you're sitting. It cleans the house, you're sitting. It comes from another planet, you're standing. You can use other TPR activities for the same thing, true or false statements. Instead of stand up, sit down, you can have things like touch your head, point to the door, point to the window. Sometimes you might have yes on one side of the wall and no written on the other side of the classroom, and they have to point to it if you prefer. Okay, so TPR is a great warmer before they then perhaps sit down and do practice on paper. So are there any questions specifically about the chain mini dialogues or the yes no TPR? Would you like to write these, not in the chat, these ones in the Q&A? Okay, no, great. The other day someone did ask me about how I encourage the child to actually know what question to ask when they're going around in the circle. For that kind of activity, I would do it a lot by whispering to the child, but in such a way that the rest of the class can hear. So pretend whispering. Okay. Does it work with older learners? The TPR does, but you change it so that it seems more age appropriate. It depends how old you want to go. Okay, you're going to have to judge the class and how well you know them. Okay, let's move on. So, to practice verbs, I think a lot of us use miming with verbs, and you can still use flashcards, because by giving the cards to the student, they pick up the card and they mime the verb, and their little group has to guess what it is they're miming. Now, for example, you're skiing. If you want this as a game to play in groups instead, to give it a little bit more challenge, give them a time limit, a pile of cards, and they have to do as many cards as they can in the time limit. And the group in the class that guesses the most cards in that time would be the winner. Okay, so this is something where you can just give it a little bit more challenge. Keeping in mind the idea of miming, I'd like to take this a step further. This is a game to practice the third person singular question. As with nearly all group lesson activities, this is best demonstrated with a few students and yourself in front of the open class before they divide into groups to continue the activity. So this is you on a chair. Ask a student A to select a word from a pile, to look at it, say nothing, and then put it back. Then you sitting in the chair face the rest of the students, and A has to start miming in silence, no sound effects. And you start asking, is he skiing? No, he isn't. Encourage them to use the full answer that you want. You can use your fingers, for example. No, 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 he isn't. Okay. Is he swimming? No, he isn't. Is he flying a kite? No, he isn't. Oh, okay, is he making sandcastles? Yes, he is. Once the children know what to do, set them into groups of ideally 4 or 5 students, with one student sitting on the chair, B, and one student, A, miming behind their back. You direct your questions to the other student, the B directs their questions to the others and they answer, and then they keep changing roles. Now, the advantage of doing this with the cards or a list of verbs on the board is that there's a finite number of verbs, and so that you're controlling which language they're going to be practicing in the game. There's a limited number of questions that they can ask rather than any verb in the English language. Okay, to develop this activity a little bit further and think about the management of the activity, here are two questions for you to write in the chat, the answers. How can you encourage students to practice both is he ing, for example, is she skiing, and is she ing, is she singing? And the second question, this is using the same activity, but how would you manage it so that this is the case? In the second question, what language can the children practice if two or three students mime the same action at the same time behind the chair? So remember, you've got groups of four or five. Could you write your answers in the chat to question one and two? Yeah, I can see some of you are referring to exactly put the mixed groups. If you have the possibility in your class, have girls and boys in each group. That's why I favour four or five in each group rather than just three. Otherwise, perhaps the girl is always only going to practice is he, because there isn't another girl in the group for her to practice is she. And the second question, of course, if there are two or three children miming behind the chair, you'd be able to practice, are they? Yes, they are. No, they aren't. As with the chain dialogue, I wouldn't necessarily do this in the same lesson. I would tend to do this when I consider that they're ready to practice the plural question. So let's move on to looking at the cards with relation to these verbs. A lot of the cards have verbs on, but some cards show an object. For example, the kite, you may use that card when you're teaching the word kite in toys. Later on, you teach collocation, fly a kite. And here you can be reusing it when you're practicing the present continuous and questions with flying a kite. And the same would apply with chess, playing chess, and throwing a ball or playing with a ball, etc. I've used this activity with a large set of verbs like this one here. I've used it with a small set, for example, those difficult verbs, hitting, kicking, throwing, catching, or bouncing a ball. Or for a topic, for example, sports. Is she playing football? Is she playing badminton, etc. So whichever actions we're including in the game, the children need some kind of finite list. Now, there's one card here. This is to remind me to tell you, to point out to you, why did I not use this verb card, falling? Well, it was very simply because I didn't want the children, at least, miming, falling and having accidents, especially not the ones I know in my classes. So we need to think about whether it's possible, predict whether it's possible to ask students to do what you're asking them to do with the cards that you choose. This is a general point, but we'll consider it with relation to this activity. Written words or pictures. We have flashcards with words on and we have flashcards with pictures. And sometimes it doesn't matter which ones we use, but sometimes there's an advantage to using the written word or an advantage to using the picture. So thinking about this activity here, which prompt is best for the student who is sitting on the chair asking the questions? Would it be better to give them the written word card or the picture card? Which one would provide more challenge? Which one would make them think about, well, how do I say that word in English? Would you like to write that in the chat? Yeah. It's true, some of you are writing both. They both work, but which one provides more challenge for the child? Okay, it would be the picture. Because when you show the picture, the child has to think, oh, how do I say kicking a ball in order to formulate the question? So it's more difficult if they have the picture card. If they have the word, they don't necessarily have to understand what they're reading. They could say, is he catching a ball? But there's no, I don't know whether they understand what they're asking. So likewise, what about for the child who mimes behind the back? Is it more useful to give that child the picture card or the written word? Think what they have to do. They need to look at the card and they need to act the card. So can you write in the chat, which is the one that makes them engage more with English? Yes, exactly. It is the written word. Okay. The activity will work and be a successful activity, whichever you use. But if you want to make it that little bit more of a challenge and be sure they're engaging with understanding the language, if you give them the written word, then they've got to mime. They've got to understand what it is they've got to mime. So I have played this instead of using flashcards. I've played it showing one of the scenes, for example, from those vocabulary books or the posters, a busy scene. We talk about the picture first and then I ask them to mime the actions that are in it instead. That's one variation. Leaving verbs, but using mime behind back activity. These are movers flashcards, and they are from the topic of health, or rather ill health or ailments. So what is the question, closed question, not an open question, that the person on the chair would ask, and what would the answers be if they were using these flashcards? Can you write your suggestions in the chat? Yes, what's the matter? But what's the matter? And then remember, they're using third person singular. That boy is miming headache. Yes, that's right. You're looking at this kind of language here. Has he got a headache? No, has he got a toothache? No, he hasn't. Has he got a backache? No, he hasn't. Has he got a headache? Yes, he has. So you're using has he got instead this time. And I've used this game a lot with this particular vocabulary because it's not so easy for them to have many opportunities to use this particular group of words. Another topic variation, which is easy for, it lends itself to miming, apart from verbs, apart from ailments, what is the topic they would practice for these flashcards? And what would be the question that the person on the chair would ask? And what would the answers be from the other students? Yeah, it's jobs. Mm-hmm. Okay, yes, is she? Well done. The dialogue would be, is she a mechanic? No, she isn't. Is she an astronaut? Yes, she is. So the children would need to mime the jobs here. So, more than vocabulary. Now, the parts of the exam where they would meet a lot of present continuous would include part one of the listening. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with the exam so far, you see the names around, they have to match the name to the person in the image. So for example, they will hear language like this. Is Jane riding a bike? No, she isn't. She's sitting on the grass next to her dog. Is William wearing glasses and reading? Yes, that's right. But in this activity, they don't just hear the present continuous. So we know we've got it in starters, movers, and flyers. So it's definitely worth spending time on this. And yes, they will hear some present continuous, but they will also hear physical descriptions. For example, Sally's got black hair or dark hair. Clothes. Harry's wearing a red and blue sweater with stripes. where the people are and prepositions. Richard's listening to his friend in front of the swans. So this moves us on to thinking about how can we encourage the students to talk about a scene and hear phrases describing a scene. So I'm going to think about another activity which doesn't just focus on present continuous. So I call this next activity a tableau activity because I put some students at the front of the class where they create a scene themselves. So I tell the students where to go and what to pretend they are doing, but they don't mime in this activity. It's more like a freeze frame, like a photograph. So for example, I say to Giorgio, Giorgio, you're sitting under the teacher's desk. You're reading a comic. And my student, Giorgio, stands, goes and sits under my desk and pretends to read a comic, but he doesn't move. I may give him a real comic if I've got one. If not, I give him the flashcard. So I tell him, I demonstrate that I want him to just hold the pose to freeze. And then I add another student, Ellie. You're standing next to the window, looking outside. I can see that you're very happy. So Ellie goes over to the window, she smiles, and she stays in pose. I continue to add students to the scene that they're creating at the front. Carla, you're behind the door, wearing a hat. You're talking to a cat. Every time I add one or two people, I loop back and consolidate the language, repeat what the picture is so far. For example, here, Giorgio is sitting under the teacher's desk. He's wearing blue trousers and reading a comic. Ellie is standing next to the window, looking outside and is very happy. Carla is talking to a cat behind a door with a hat on. So you continue to loop back and to recap and add another person. Once I've got about 7 or 8 students in this tableau, I would ask the remaining students who are not in the scene to speak about it. For example, Giorgio's wearing blue trousers. They don't have to say the exact same order, anything they can say talking about the scene. Because some of them are holding realia and flashcards, it will help them to think of things that they can say about it. So we're using the type of language and skills that will be picked up in listening parts 1, and in some cases, parts 3, and we're developing skills towards the reading and writing paper. But I'll come back to that in a moment. If you want to take this a step further for higher level classes, encourage the students to dictate a tableau. Give some flashcards, I chose words this time, to some students, and they have to make up instructions to give other students. So for example, I put aside Lenny, Dahlia, and Pat, you wait instruction. I give the rest of the class these words here. They make up some instructions and say, for example, Lenny, you're doing a puzzle and wearing sunglasses. So student Lenny goes and pretends to do those things. Pat, you're sitting in front of the whiteboard and eating a banana. Dahlia, you're roller skating behind the teacher's desk. You've got brown hair. So those students, Lenny, Pat, and Dahlia, do as they're told. To develop the tableau into a follow-up written practice, the class, once they've got the scene in front, ask the class to tell you what they see, and they dictate, you write up the description of the tableau. Once you've written it, rub out some of the vocabulary, ask the children to copy the description, but to complete the gaps. This is gradually leading the students towards the reading and writing, as well as supporting the listening training. So in Movers, for example, reading and writing part six, they have a scene, and the first two questions, they have to complete the sentences about the scene, in the second two questions, they have to answer open questions. And the last two questions in this activity, in this exercise, they have to write two sentences about the picture. So you're also encouraging them to think about what they can say, and also stronger students, you're encouraging them to give longer sentences and perhaps get higher marks. So are there any questions about the miming behind backs and tableau activities? Anything that you want to ask about those? Someone asking about how long would you make the activities last? Actually, if it were a 90-minute lesson, Anna, or something shorter, I wouldn't decide how long an activity lasts based on the number of minutes of the lesson. I would decide how long an activity lasts according to how well the activity is going, how it's being received by the students, whether they're engaging with it, and that innate ability that teachers have and need to tell when to stop an activity, whether it's too difficult, whether it's easy, etc. Okay, so yes, lesson wise, I would say, in answer to your question, the miming behind backs, I have done it for 10 minutes. It usually takes at least 10 minutes for them to really get into it, with turn taking as well. I've done it for 20 minutes as another time, when there were perhaps more verbs. But 10 to 15 minutes is probably typical, but I would never suggest a time limit. It has to be judged by the teacher, right? So let's move on to something completely different activity-wise. Does anyone know which exam, young learner exam, this one comes from? Well, actually, if you focus really tight, it's even written. It's actually from Flyers. It's the speaking paper, and it's an information exchange. And most of us use information exchanges of some type in our teaching. In the exam, the examiner asks five questions, and children answer the five questions about these characters illustrated above. The student is given the basic information, and then afterwards the student asks five questions about the other person, and the teacher will answer them. The student is not given the full question, they're just given a prompt, but we're going to build up towards that. So let's see if flashcards can help us here. Can you imagine that I'm your teacher for a moment? Sarah and Oliver have favorite places. I don't know anything about Sarah's favorite place, but you do. So I'm going to ask you some questions. Look at the picture and answer the question. Don't write these in the chat, just say them. Where is Sarah's favorite place? Yes, you're right. It's the waterfall. What can she do there? Very good. She can take photographs. We continue like this, adding questions and showing them a specific answer card. So as teachers, can you look at my next flashcard? And can you suggest what is the question that you would have next to this flashcard? What is the question that you would ask if you're in your demonstration, or the students would ask if they were practicing? Remember, we're still thinking about Sarah and her favorite place. The context is that her favorite place is the waterfall and she takes photographs there. Could you write your idea for the question here? Yeah, actually, did she see a helicopter would work? How did she get there? We were actually talking about her favorite place. So yeah, I would go with present simple. Yes, any of those. How does she get there? How can she get there? How does she go there? Yeah, exactly. Okay, so we had three, in this example, I had three questions in the same context. The favorite places. Let's continue with Oliver. However, if you want to make this more interesting for the children in the next stage, give them a choice of how to answer the question as they work in pairs. So I'm still giving the full question at this point. So now let's look at Oliver. You don't know anything about Oliver's favorite place, A, but your partner, B, does. Ask your partner the questions. B, look at the pictures, choose one answer, and answer your partner's questions. So A, where is Oliver's favorite place? B, chooses the answer that they want to give from this selection. This is just an alternative, it's not obligatory. It's the jungle. Okay. What can he do there? He can walk the dog. How does he go there? By rocket. Okay. So to manage the information exchange, you can either continue to show them the cards on the screen as I did, while they ask and answer in their pairs. That means you're controlling the speed because you're holding the class all at the same pace. Or leave a list of questions on the board. And if you want the children to work at their own pace, give them a pile of cards for them to pick up and answer with. If you want them to choose the words, then that encourages perhaps a little bit more fun. If you want to oblige them to use a word, they just pick up one and have to answer when they turn it over. The advantage of that is that they have to also say words they don't know so well and won't stay safe always with car, 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 for example. So if you are changing, instead of favorite place, imagine we're moving on to talk about Pat. And Pat went somewhere last weekend. So simple past questions here. If I were asking the question, where did she go? As a teacher, which cards could you select as prompts? Not using the ones I've just shown you, Mountain Lake, but think about other cards that you might use as answers there. And my second question for you is, what question could they practice if you showed people here? This is the context. Pat went somewhere last weekend. Answer these questions about Pat and where she went last weekend. Okay. Yeah, a farm, bowling, restaurant, park places. Yes, exactly what I have in mind there as well. Things like she went to the museum, she went to the park, she went to the swimming pool. Other things like went to the cafe or went to the theater or the stadium. There are loads of other places, cards and vocabulary that you can revise at the same time as practicing this. If you were showing people cards, there are different questions. Like someone wrote, who did she visit? But you might have, who did she go there with? Okay. So this, however, has all been with us providing the full question. As your young learners are ready, you can move them towards being closer to the actual exam task when it's their turn to formulate the question and ask the examiner. So a more challenging practice is to be fed prompts rather than the question. So these are still fuller prompts than the actual test, which would be one or two words, but you're encouraging them to think, okay, our friend Oliver is going to a birthday party. You don't know anything about the birthday party, so you ask some questions about it. What's Oliver wearing to the party? What present is he giving his friend? Where does Oliver's friend live? So again, gradually you're training towards the exam. Okay, your everything you do is valid teaching. We're not specifically teaching for the test, but we're keeping the test in the back of our mind. So the example of the birthday party and the favorite place, I thought that they were quite good examples because I could think of two or three or even four or five questions that fitted with the same context. But sometimes you might find it easier to just have isolated questions. For example, you find some pastime activities here and the question, what does Oliver like doing? So there are many questions that I think can be used with information exchanges. There's an infinite amount that you can think of that would fit with topics like jobs, places, transport. For example, you can have an isolated question. What does she like doing with her granny? She likes cooking sausages. You might have groups of three or four questions that fit into specific contexts. And you can have fun ones in the lessons too, like what's his mother's job? She's the queen. Where does she work in the castle? How does she go to work by plane? So we are continually reusing and recycling our teaching resources. We may use flashcards to prompt sentence building, questions and exchanges. For example, we had our kite card, which we'd use with toys. Then we can use it with the miming with the verbs, and we can also use it as something in an information exchange. Whilst we prepare our students for different parts of the young learner tests, we can also prepare for speaking, listening, and the writing at the same time. Everything is useful for every other skill. So I hope you've got some ideas on how you can reuse the same cards and the same activities for different language. Now, when it comes to making up and storing material, you might find it practical, obviously, to print a page where you get these are in booklets, so you'd get 12 on a page. When you do this, they're therefore obviously the smaller cards. So I'd like you to think about the activities mentioned today. Which are the ones that work well with small sets of cards? I mean, it's fantastic if the children have actually got their own set each, but thinking about typical classes, which are the activities that I've shown you today, that we've talked about today, that work well with sets of small cards, ones that they can see close by? They don't have to be shown at the front of the classroom. Could you write in the chat what the activities were? The tableau when you're giving them the cards and holding them, fast finger, if it's on a table perhaps. Memory game, yes, absolutely. Okay, so these are the activities that I would say work okay with small cards. Kim's game and disappearing words, if you're playing it on the table, for example, the children have started to take turns to be the teacher where they move a card and put it back for their classmates. The chain mini dialogues, when they pass it round, they can see it, it's small. All of those, when you're working in groups, when they can see the cards close. Back to back is the first one there. I haven't shown you that, but it's one of my favorite activities. I put the students into pairs and they sit literally back to back. For this, they need the same set of cards each, probably about eight pieces of vocabulary. At starters level, I would have it one student, number one is a sheep. Number two, a duck. Number three, and they place the cards. Student B listens and puts the cards in the same order. Then they stand up, look and check that they've ordered them in the same way. Pushing that up to movers where they learn ordinal numbers, encourage them to say, first there's the sheep, then the duck is second, put the frog third. After that is the tiger. And finally, there's the lizard. not only the ordinal numbers, but great for linking phrases, which is also guiding them towards linking when they're doing storytelling, which is included in the exams. So, however, sometimes we need to have activities where we're showing cards on the screen to a class, and the people at the back of the class need to be able to see it. So we may be snipping and saving in the computer and printing as big flashcards, or we may be using them on our interactive whiteboards, or if you're doing online lessons, showing them there. I would just say, from personal experience, remember to save them with a name so that you can find them again, especially after a period of time, maybe storing them in files with clear labeling. Which of the activities mentioned today work better with sets of big flashcards? Which of the activities which were, let's face it, basically teacher-centered activities where I want them to be able to see from the back of the class too? Okay, can you write in the chat the activities you'd say there? Yeah, some of you would say the tableau. I suppose if you're giving them a prompt card and the children want, you want to see that they're holding a comic or a hat. The TPR with the alien, absolutely. Yeah, not all TPR, but the one with the yes, no activity, yes. Okay, so let's look here. The Kim's Game or Disappearing Words when you were managing it yourself on your board. The alien, friendly alien activity, the teacher-led one, that has to be a big picture. The miming behind backs, although they can have that with their own set, but if you're doing it where you have them on the board and they just have that as a checklist, and starting them off on the information exchange when you're showing them how to do it before you put them in groups. Now, again, here, one of the ones that I would like to tell you now is the TPR. In fact, someone asked, I saw in the questions, any other TPR. There are so many TPR activities, but the one that I would suggest is very useful here for starters speaking, but all of the papers for listening with prepositions. Have a few cards and say, which is the panda? Someone comes and picks up the panda. Can you put the panda under your chair? Where's the astronaut? Put the astronaut on Giorgio's head. Ask the children to place about eight cards, I would suggest six or eight cards around the room. If you use small ones, it works, but the advantage of using a big one is that then after you can say, so where is the astronaut? And they can see, and they feed back the phrases to you. So, bingo and stepping stones are mentioned in the little booklet, the little guide that comes with the flashcards. There are some activities here, as well as the ones looked at today in the webinar. Because flashcards are an expensive resource, if you're buying them in boxes, one advantage of these online ones is that you can select the ones that you know that you're going to use and use fully, and collaborate with your colleagues to share them. I hope that you've got some ideas here for preparing. And are there any other questions about activities or flashcards that we've looked at today? Would you like to write them in the Q&A? How do you keep other students engaged when they're not in the tableau? I never, ever had a problem with that. They're interested in looking at their classmates and they don't know if they're going to be called up the tableau. And also, in fact, I tend to put quite disruptive students in the tableau. In fact, usually the first two child that I would pick to put in it tends to be the one that's a bit of a monkey. Okay. Someone mentioning about online lessons. Yes, they are student-focused activities and thinking mostly about class. I would still do, in online lessons, I would still do TPR. I'd be checking that they're standing up and pointing and so on. The thing about online lessons is that you're spending longer preparing your screen Putting the images into PowerPoint can be the quickest and easiest way to manage it if you know you're going to use it more than once in particular. Okay, so let me just show you how do you find the resources. If you go to the Cambridge site and click on exams and tests and preparation, you will find the access to the flashcards, the word picture books, the vocabulary lists, and the handbooks, which also contain the vocabulary lists. And very importantly, you would find sample papers, two full sample papers for that final bit of preparation. These are links you might want to screenshot, but this is a recorded webinar. It will go onto the YouTube channel, so you can also see them there. The posters, I highly recommend. They're busy, lots to talk about in them, and they link again with the flashcards. If you go to the CUP catalogue, you'll see what other resources are available. And that brings us to the end of our time today. So I hope that this that you enjoy preparing your starters, movers, and flyers.